Hi, this is Kimberly. Happy Thanksgiving to Kimberly's people, to the people that have taught me I don't have to hate the holidays. I have y'all. Y'all are good people. For those that don't understand, that's a United States informal, old-fashioned way to say someone is an honest, helpful, or morally good individual. In order to use this phrase correctly, for example, if you want to use this to describe only one person, you must use incorrect grammar. Never ever switch good people to good person. And I'm okay with using incorrect grammar. I won't mark your comment down as incorrect and hand it back to you. Nothing like that. So to review, good people is someone who deep down inside has a good heart, will have your back in a time of crisis, and automatically assume that you are innocent of any wrongdoing in any given situation. Take Tim Bell, for example. He would be described as good people. For those of you that don't know, that means you've not been watching the Chris Meth Lab and Courtney Dingbell trial videos, and shame on you for that, but Tim Bell is Courtney Bell's father. He meets this criteria. He would never for one second think that Courtney was guilty of anything. But honestly, he really is good people. I didn't mean that to sound mean, but I think he believes in his daughter a little too much. They themselves are deficient in evil and associate with you because they assume the same about you. So, happy Thanksgiving to Kimberly's people. Y'all are good people, and each one of you individually is good people as well. So, I was going through some of my notes that I told y'all about the other day, and I decided to pull out this story, as it doesn't really seem to go with anything else, and being that it's a holiday, Thanksgiving, I was just gonna post a Thanksgiving video with some of my favorite old vintage stuff. Y'all know I love black and white shows and black and white anything, but I was gonna just post a Thanksgiving video without me talking. But then I knew that would upset those of you that like to hear me running my mouth. It doesn't matter what I do, someone will be indignant. And then that's when I remembered that I made a promise to myself a while back that I'm gonna start doing what pleases me for the rest of my life. I won't become a selfish arse, don't worry, but when it doesn't hurt anyone else, I will do so. I will do what pleases me, which translates to, I'm going to do what the fuck I want to do. Now, only if my memory would cooperate with all of these grand ideas that I come up with. I was going to use the word grandioloquent or grandioquilent. I can't say the word, which is just as well, because I thought it meant grand and eloquent at the same time. But when I looked it up, because I like to know of whence I speak, grandoquilent, glam dolly, help me out with this word. Grandoquilent means pompous or extravagant in language, style, or manner, especially in a way that is intended to impress. My husband used to accuse me of that when we were dating, and for the first several years of our marriage, he said I was talking down to him and trying to show how smart I was by talking over his head with what he called big words. And now he understands and knows that it's just a quirky part of my character. If you had grown up with black and white TV, which I love, by the way, and no cable television, no video games, and only jacks, jump rope, sidewalk chalk, stuff like that, deck of cards, and an assortment of dolls and stuffed animals, well, you read a lot. I was desperate to read. I would even read our incomplete set of encyclopedias when I was desperate. Did I ever tell y'all about how I would beg my father, in the summertime especially, but even during school on the weekends, to drop me off at the library for hours on end? You can't do that shit now. You'll get arrested. I would check out as many books as I could carry, often dropping them on the way back to his 1970 Plymouth Gold Duster. And I would feel like a kid at Christmas, and he would probably roll his eyes at me. I never saw him do that, but probably. He just would wordlessly watch me, you know, stumbling and dropping and shit. And anyway, but... Oh, and the jacks and the stuff and jump rope and all that. Those weren't my only toys. I had stuff like a Light Bright and the original Easy Bake Oven, stuff like that. And those were all kept in the original boxes and would go on the very top shelf of my closet. I only got toys at Christmas time. My birthday is in September. I would always get back to school clothes for my birthday. And other than that, you didn't get a damn toy. So you just didn't even bother asking. But yeah, I had one of the original Easy Bake Ovens. And I loved that damn thing. I made everybody a cake on their birthday. Only my parents appreciated it. I think I only made it for them because my brothers were not worthy. But yeah, I kept always everything in their original box in the top shelf of my closet, and they were only brought out on special occasions, such as a rainy Sunday afternoon if I didn't have anything to read. But if I did, I would lay on the couch all afternoon in our formal living room. It was red crushed velvet, and that room was only used for social occasions. You know, everyone had a formal living room. It was never ever for playing. We had a den, you know, where outside was where we played for the most part. But the formal living room, it was also used for formal arguments. So anyway, with all of my reading, I picked up a few words. It was bound to happen. I was that nerd that would go to bed early so that I had enough time to read before it was lights out. And whenever I was reading and my brother would walk past the formal living room, and he would call me names. Mean shit, too. A lot of it you can't even say today. And he would even poke his head in my bedroom when I was in there reading and call me names. It wasn't just when I was reading, it was all the time. But wanted to tell y'all about this story about my mom. And I just wanted to interject real quick as I'm editing. I don't think I ever finished telling this story, but my ADD has been wide open, full speed, all day. So, as usual, please forgive me. Thank you. When I was a kid back in the psychedelic 1970s, my mother was going through a phase of fancying herself as a college professor, probably at somewhere like Berkeley. On other days, I think when she was hungover, it was more a Yale or Harvard professor. But she would stand in the middle of our modestly middle-class suburban kitchen, decked out with some rather loud wallpaper and mushroom designs on the canisters and lined up on the formica countertops, and that would be covered in grease as though it was a greasy spoon diner. And she would be waving her wooden spoon around that was not just for cooking but for spankings. It had a split down the middle. It got a lot. It got a good workout, but the lectures that she would give as she waved that around would vary greatly. She had a few favorites, though. One of the ones was about laziness, and the reason I give you that is not my fault. It's because it's in my bloodline. My father got it from his father, who got it from my grandfather, who I call Granddaddy. Well, you know what I mean. It was handed down from generation to generation. And this shocked me a great deal the first time I heard it, but I got used to it after a while. It seems that all of them, my father, his father, even his father, they were all lazy bastards and would only do stuff when my grandma hollered at them, or my mom, or my great-grandma, and they would have to tell them in painstaking detail what the fuck to do from start to finish. I had no idea. To me, he was perfect. And my idol as a little girl, Granddaddy, was. He always greeted me with a dashing smile and a twinkle in his eye. I think he was the real Santa Claus. And I would sit on his lap, and he would tell me stories as Southern granddaddies do, and he always called me Little Edna. I do believe he had a crush on my mom. All men had a crush on my mom. She looked, at least to me, and I think a lot of people, but she looked very much like Elizabeth Taylor, and she always loved to tell us stories about when people would tell her so. But she was Liz with a British accent. But Granddaddy could do no wrong in my eyes. It would hurt me when my mom would tell me that he was a lazy bastard, and that's why my daddy was a lazy bastard, and so on and so forth and what have you. I had trouble accepting it, although I never knew it, thank goodness, until after his death when I was 7 years old. Oh, how I cried and cried. I still go quiet and stare into space when I think of it. It was very, very unexpected. I mean, he had fallen ill. He had had a stroke. He was eating breakfast when he fell out of his chair onto the kitchen floor when he had the stroke. Grandma had just called to tell us he would be discharged from the hospital soon. Couple of weeks in rehab he would have, and then home. And she was so happy. We all were. I remember nearly every single detail. I remember the scratchy wool jumper I had to wear to the funeral, the ice storm, the horrifying drive that took us about 6 or 7 hours when normally 2, 2.5 hours before the interstates were built, skidding off the icy roads multiple times and spinning out. In those days, car crashes were often fatal, so it was heart-pounding. I remember it, my mother screaming. We literally spun out on the ice. Did a 360. And I remember when the phone call came and my mom hung up the phone quietly. I said, "He's dead." And she just looked at me and didn't say anything, and my brother told me to shut up, you know, mad. And I had been helping her prepare lunch. She went upstairs to tell my father. We all waited down in the kitchen, and he was sleeping because he had been on the night shift. Dang, there's so much to tell about this story. I'll have to come back to it in another one, but I didn't know I was going to go down this road. You know, this ice storm lasted for days on end, and there was no power. There was 20-something people in my grandparents' old 3-bedroom farmhouse that had the 3 bedrooms, a living room and kitchen, and a recently added on full bathroom in the late 60s, I think it was. It was such a charming house, and my grandparents had a way with everything they touched. It was perfect, but we were all sleeping on the floor. I'll come back to this story. I was going to tell you a lot more, but y'all, please, I have a really good story to tell you about my grandma's biscuits, but not right now. I think I'm getting upset missing my parents and stuff, so I don't know. It hits you when you least expect it. It's been 5 years now. They died within 4 months of each other in 2015. Happy Thanksgiving, Mom and Dad, and heaven. With it being a holiday, I can guarantee you they're having what my mom would call a big dust up. We've had all kinds of events happen on holidays. 1 year, the turkey went down the back stairs of their house. Yeah. Please stay tuned to see some of the shit I like. I love old vintage commercials and such, and there's even a little turkey history lesson at the end of this video if you care to watch it. So remember, the word or phrase of the day is good people, widely used in the South or pretty much in rural areas throughout the United States. And remember, the correct way to use it is to describe an individual, as in, he's good people, or their entire family's character, such as, he comes from good people. And this is one instance where correct grammar is a non-issue. In fact, it is an issue if you change it around to use proper grammar. I love you guys very much every day and twice on Sundays. Have a great Thanksgiving, and thank you very much for listening. Much love and peace.
Here's to all the early mornings. To the last minute surprises. And even to the ones that never made it to the table at all. Here's to the year the power went out. The year the sparks flew. To the overcooked, the overfed, the overtime. Here's to the biggest kids' table on the street. Here's to the day that may not always be flawless. But it's always perfect. Happy Thanksgiving from Publix.
Wow. Say, you gals think you're lucky you can get Swanson TV turkey dinners, but I say Swanson TV turkey dinners are a bigger break for husbands. Now, you take me. I can be early, I can be late, I can bring pals to dinner anytime I please, and get this, my wife never panics. She just takes Swanson TV turkey dinners from the freezing compartment of our refrigerator when I'm a little off schedule.
Oh, and right you are, Jack. And that is because Mary Lou knows that she can have a swell dinner ready in just 25 minutes.
Right.
And talk about easy. Well, she just pops Swanson TV turkey dinners in a hot oven. You know, they're oven ready in individual heat and serve trays. With Swanson TV turkey dinners, you just heat and serve, and you serve big and hearty slices of moist, tender Swanson turkey with grand giblet gravy and special cornbread dressing and fluffy whipped sweet potatoes with golden Swanson butter and garden fresh peas with more butter.
Mother Murphy, lucky me. My wife uses Swanson TV turkey dinners. And make your husband lucky, too. Get Swanson TV turkey dinners, Swanson TV fried chicken dinners, Swanson TV beef dinners from your grocer's big freezer.
It's news, real food news. Turkey, once only a fall and winter holiday star, can now, because of better ways of breeding, a pattern, table-dressed, quick-frozen, be put on your table when you want it, 365 days in the year. Not just at Thanksgiving and Christmas, but in June or July, April or May. And it's news, too, good news, that now there's a turkey for every size family. 12 to 25 pounders for large families, and a new 5 to 10 pound variety for smaller families. With all this good news, we in the Marie Gifford Kitchen wanted to make sure that the information was made available to every homemaker. So we prepared to send out a special service bulletin on the newest in round-the-year ways to buy and serve turkey. One of the big headlines is that today, instead of the long-established way of getting a turkey, only partially oven-ready, in the style known as New York dressed, you can buy a turkey that is completely and immediately ready for stuffing and roasting. That's the modern, quick-frozen, table-dressed turkey. And the other headliners are the new Beltsville turkeys, weighing only 5 to 10 pounds, meal size, small family size, a new breed, especially developed by the United States Department of Agriculture Experiment Station at Beltsville, Maryland. Specially selected birds, as are all these turkeys. Buttermilk and grain-fed, expertly, completely cleaned, the turkey's transparent wrap to keep in moisture, all the fine flavor quick-frozen in. The larger ones, labeled as to the exact kind of bird, hen or tom, exact weight shown on every bird, table-dressed, ready for the oven, ready at their peak of flavor perfection any time in the year. That is news. To compare costs between a New York-dressed and one of these table-dressed turkeys, a New York-dressed turkey was weighed as it is sold at the market, with head and feet on, viscera in. This is the weight you pay for in such turkeys. This is what you have left to cook. Here are the discarded parts. The turkey has lost nearly one-fifth of its original weight. When you buy a convenient table-dressed bird of the same weight, you pay only for the meat you can eat. As you can see here. So with a fine value story to feature, into our bulletin go notes on how to give quick-frozen, table-dressed turkeys treatment worthy of their fine quality. First, how to defrost. If you have plenty of time, let defrost gradually, in your refrigerator, in the regular food compartment. Allow 24 hours at least. Or if you're in a hurry, put under cool running water for 1 to 3 hours. When just pliable, the leg can be moved. Turkey's ready. And once defrosted, don't refreeze. Turkey's a delicate food. Thaw and cook and eat. Now, defrosted and flavor fresh, the turkey's ready for the finest dressing, giblet dressing. First, remove the parchment-wrapped packages of giblets. Place in salted water sufficient to cover. Be sure to get giblets from neck cavity. And simmer 1 hour. Chop giblets fine for the dressing and save the broth for both dressing and gravy. And here are the ingredients for a magnificently flavorful stuffing. This quantity will be right for a 12-pound bird. A 6-pound meal-sized bird would use just half as much. 3 quarts of bread cubes are toasted. The toasting really adds flavor. Over the toasted bread cubes, pour a mixture made by browning lightly, 3/4 cup of chopped celery, and 3/4 cup of onion, in 3/4 cup of butter or margarine. Then add 1 tablespoon of chopped parsley, 1 tablespoon of salt, 1/4 teaspoon pepper, 3/4 teaspoon of poultry seasoning, the giblets, turkey goes with so many dishes. For this dinner, say for a Sunday in March, we suggest crabapple pickles, buttered green beans, mashed potatoes, a crisp salad. The turkey's out of the oven. A meal-sized belt's bill, 5 to 7 pounds. Just right for a family of 4 to 5. And there it is, eating ready. The family's just as ready, and there's that bird. A delicacy to feature, to make any meal festive. Easy to serve, calendar round. Picnic time. Time for a take-along potluck dish, for picnic or any neighborhood social. A dish that fits perfectly. Turkey rice casserole. Cube about 3 cups of the meat of a cold, already cooked turkey. Ready, boiling, 5 cups of broth made from bones and skin. Add 1 cup of raw rice, 1/3 cup of chopped celery, and 1/3 cup of chopped onion. Cook until the rice is soft, but not mushy. Then add 1/4 cup of green pepper, 1/4 cup of chopped pimento, 1½ to 2 teaspoons of salt, 3/4 teaspoon of Worcestershire sauce, and the cubed turkey. Put it in a casserole, edge with 1/4 cup of breadcrumbs, mixed with 1 tablespoon of melted butter. Bake 1 hour in a 350-degree oven. The distinctive flavor of good, rich bites of turkey, combined with all the flavors of the sauce, makes this a social star, picnic or party, a dish that is news, that makes news. And now June, and here comes the bride. And here's a wedding buffet as beautiful as she is, a buffet crowned by wedding cake, and the perfect occasion salad, turkey almond salad. For family-sized proportions, cube 2 cups of cold turkey. Add half this quantity, 1 cup, of fine red grapes seeded, 1 cup delicately thin slices of green celery, and sprinkle with crisply toasted almonds. Just enough dressing to moisten. Turkey with fruit and celery, and with the almonds, a dish to remember. We heap it in a bowl lined with spring fresh lettuce. It must then be kept well chilled until ready to serve. Before serving, sprinkle with almonds. for the wedding buffet, put in individual lettuce cups. Shine up your prettiest silver tray and serve to make a memorable addition to a memorable day. So here's to them. May their home be graced with many a fine turkey dinner. Together. July and August, summer out of doors. The hot months of the year. Months to get out of the kitchen in the hot hours of the day. To eat in the cool breezeway, out in the patio, under the trees. Now the cold roast turkey stars. A fine, plump-breasted turkey to be cooked in the cool of the day, served in good, generous slices with sweet, fresh corn, sliced tomatoes, and a coolly refreshing salad bowl. A new life for the cook. New life for heat-exhausted appetites. By the way, no need to stuff if you're serving the turkey cold. Unstuffed, allow less time, too. Only 10 to 12 minutes per pound. And cold turkey's good to keep ready in the refrigerator at any time, in the same way you can have ever ready that other guest insurance, a cold ham. And about midnight, there may be an extra meal slipped in for turkey nibblers only. A fine roast turkey ready in the refrigerator. That's eating. That's living. Time for an impromptu father and son banquet on the side. A chance to get together to share mutual tastes. Then, on a cool October night, what better than crisp, hot turkey pinwheels with mushroom sauce? A happy return engagement recipe for any turkey. For these, roll biscuit dough thin. Mix chopped turkey with chopped onion and green pepper, cooked in a little butter. Add pepper and 1/2 teaspoon of salt. And sufficient cream to moisten. Spread over biscuit dough, not quite to the edge. Roll as for a jelly roll, gently. Even up the ends. Cut in 1 1/2 inch slices. Place on a cookie sheet and bake.
flavorful golden brown turkey is the crowning glory of your holiday dinner table. And real butter helps you serve a butter-baked masterpiece. Here's how to butter-bake your turkey. After stuffing the bird, pat lots of soft butter all over, especially on the drumsticks, breast, and wings. Next, cover the entire turkey with cheesecloth dipped in melted butter to protect it from shrinking in your oven. Then bake it slowly, without a lid, never higher than 300 to 325 degrees. Every half hour, baste with butter. When it's golden brown, you'll serve your family and guests the juiciest, tenderest turkey ever because you use butter. This year, bake your holiday turkey the American Dairy Association way with real butter.
I'm Bill Johnson. Around here, they just call me Dad. I've been trying to read, but I just can't seem to do it. I keep thinking about today, Thanksgiving Day. We Johnsons had a good Thanksgiving, the best we've ever had. And I can't help thinking that what made it better was a feeling, a real feeling of thankfulness. And that's odd, too, when you consider the shape things were in when I got home from work yesterday. Kids, Dick and Tommy and Susan, were all home from school. And of course, Mother and the baby were there. As kids will, mine were living tomorrow right along with today, looking forward to Thanksgiving. And like most men, I'm glad it was Mother instead of me who had to break the news to them.
Tomorrow's Thanksgiving.
Turkey and dressing and pie and cake.
And fruit salad and whipped cream and cranberries. Gee, I can hardly wait.
Me too.
Well, you know, children, we've had a lot of expenses this month, and, well, your father and I thought that... Well, the truth of the matter is, there just won't be any turkey this year.
No turkey for Thanksgiving?
Oh, I'm going to make a pumpkin pie, and we'll have plenty to eat, but, well, we'll just have to get along without turkey.
Mom, you don't mean it. It won't be Thanksgiving at all.
Even the pilgrims had a feast. After all, isn't that what Thanksgiving's for? I don't think it's fair.
And it was right there that I came in, right in the thick of it. Hello, everybody.
Hi, Pa.
Hello, Mother, Dick, Susan. Well, what's been going on around here? What's the matter with everybody, anyway?
Mom says we're not going to have any Thanksgiving.
No turkey, no good thing.
A fat lot we're going to have to be thankful for.
I don't think you kids really mean that.
We do, too. We've always had turkey for Thanksgiving.
Yes, and everybody else in the block's going to have it this year. Same as always.
Yes, we've always had turkey, just as a lot of Americans have had it, and we'll keep on having it. Turkey on Thanksgiving's a great American tradition. But what you kids are saying makes it sound as if the turkey's the only thing we had to be thankful for.
Well, gee whiz, no, Dad. It's not that at all.
Oh, I know, Dick. With turkey, it's easy to lose sight of what Thanksgiving really means.
And don't think we're just making excuses because we don't have any turkey this year. We know it'll mean a lot more to us the next time we do have it.
Well, sure. Suppose we don't have a bang-up feast. We're still a lot better off than the pilgrims.
That's it, Dick. Do you other kids see what Dick's trying to say? Turkey or no turkey, we've still got all the freedoms and privileges the pilgrims gave us. And out of those privileges have come a lot of things. Things the pilgrims never even dreamed of.
Why, we could make a list a mile long.
Why don't we do it?
But now, hold on a minute. You've got the idea, but it isn't something you can write down like a grocery list. You've got to feel it down deep before you can really be thankful for anything. I tell you what let's do. Let's take a little more time to think this over. When you get right down to it, there are some pretty tough decisions in making up your mind what means the most to you. Your life? Sure, that's one thing you can't get along without. But do you know that there are some places in the world today where you have to get along without just about everything else?
Golly, Daddy.
I guess I kind of got carried away. But I'll bet you one thing. If we really think over what we have to be thankful for, when we sit down to whatever Mother fixes to eat tomorrow, we'll be one family in America that will really have a Thanksgiving dinner. Well, that's how it got started. The Johnsons didn't have any turkey. And the kids, no, I mean everybody, likes to make something special out of a special day. So we fell back on something as old as the Pilgrims, toting up the common, ordinary blessings that we had to be thankful for. That night, I'd see Dick there building his model airplane and Susan just playing. Only they weren't just playing. They were mulling things over, thinking big thoughts for such young heads. And as for Mother and Tom and baby Janet, and yes, me too, it was as if we had our eyes open for the first time, things there were to appreciate in just any ordinary day in America. When we took our places around the table and we were ready, and then, well, we all knew it, there are some things you just can't say. But everybody in his own way knew what he had to be thankful for, and that this was the time to think about it. Tom was first.
I am thankful for getting plenty to eat all the time, with extras that count, like cookies and milk after school. Like Mom says, I'm hungry all the time anyway, and if I didn't live in a country where there was plenty to go around, golly! And I'm thankful for the free public library, where I can get books about adventure. Jack London, Richard Halliburton. Gee, the way they tell a story, it's as good as being there yourself. And it's free, with only a library card.
Yes, Tommy thought about some of the things he ought to be glad for all the time. And somehow, turkey and trimming seemed to matter a whole lot less than he thought they did yesterday. Well, then it was Susan's turn. Susan's a happy-go-lucky kid. You'd never credit her with thinking beyond her dolls, but she got right into the spirit of it.
I am thankful we have what we need to wear, though Mother says it's hard to keep up with us, we grow so fast. I never thought before how many clothes it takes for all kinds of weather, or how it would be to have to do without the right ones. I'm glad to be able to go to Sunday school, or go to any church I want, any Sunday. I'm thankful for my mother and daddy, that they are here with us, that both of them aren't too worried about things to take time to have fun with us. I'm glad we're a family, that families are still important in America.
I guess Dick, being the oldest, was having some pretty serious thoughts.
I am thankful for being able to get an education, for living where schools, all schools, open their doors to a guy who wants to learn, where school books are studied instead of burned, where a guy's rated by how much he knows, and the community is rated by how well it teaches him. I'm glad I've got a chance to play, batting a ball around once in a while. Stuff like that. I'm glad it's fun, growing up in America.
Sure, baby Janet's too young to understand the big word, Thanksgiving. She's too little even to tell us the things that make her happy. But we can tell, and maybe she's thinking about them now. Maybe she's thinking about the fun of splashing around in the tub, and about how good it feels to be clean. About playtime with Mother, and the security she feels in Mother's arms. And as for Mother, seems she's always working, cooking, ironing, tending children, daylight to dark. What does she have to be thankful for?
I am thankful that my children had the privilege of being born safely and of growing up healthy and strong. I'm thankful that I have the privilege of guiding them as they become useful men and women. And I'm thankful for all the things our American system makes possible for the Smiths and the Browns and the Johnsons, for washing machines, hot water out of a tap, and a telephone to call the doctor when one of the family is sick. A car to get Dad to work. Yes, I'm thankful for all the things free people working together can produce. I'm thankful that when my neighbor drops in to borrow a cup of flour, we've got the right to talk about anything we want to. The parent-teacher project, the new mayor, or Jane Jones' hat. And last of all, I'm truly thankful for the peace of mind that Dad's job brings, for knowing that even though there are lots of luxuries we can't afford, there still will always be enough to go around for the things we have to have. I'm glad Dad doesn't work slave hours, that there are evenings and Sundays and vacations when we can all be together.
That's Mother for you, grateful for what America means to her family. And now for me. I've got so many things to be thankful for. I'm thankful for this house. It may need a coat of paint, it has a mortgage, but it's ours, a place where we can be together in privacy. And I'm thankful for the thing that makes this house our home, the happiness here. Not just today or on Christmas morning, but on a day-to-day basis all through the year. For knowing that a knock on our door means nothing to fear. A friend calling, or maybe a bill collector, or a kid selling magazines. You never know what to expect. But you can count on one thing. It's not going to be some political gangster coming to drag one of us off to jail because we believe in freedom. And I'm glad that that freedom we've got lets me choose the kind of work I like and can do best. Taking a sluggish motor and making it hum again. Makes me feel that somebody got to his work, or wherever he had to go, just because of me. And feeling like that gives me a lot of satisfaction. And I'm thankful for my newspaper. Just a few cents worth of printer's ink and paper, but more valuable than any amount of money. Because in it, the editor's got the privilege of printing what he thinks. And I've got the privilege of agreeing with him or not, however the facts strike me. And both of us, the editor and I, have the right to act on our opinions on election day, to vote for the principles we believe in. And finally, I'm thankful for being able to believe, in spite of everything, that somehow, someway, the unity we've got here in the Johnson family will someday spread to men and nations throughout the world. For all these things, we are truly and humbly thankful. Amen.